Good morning, everybody, and welcome to our next session. This is session 8C, fecal sludge treatment and management and wastewater. So in this morning's session, we will have two presentations only. For those of you who don't know me, my name is Tanya Radu, and I will have Pranesh Kartikeyan here with me, so two of us will co-chair this session. So, as I said, two presentations. We will play videos of each, and then we'll have 10 minutes for questions. The first presentation is a comparative study on fecal sludge treatment plants with different treatment technologies by Sakti Balasubramani. I hope I pronounced that well, Sakti. Yes? So, yes, we'll play the presentation now. No, this is James.
Good day to everyone. I'm Sakti Balasubramani from Indian Institute for Human Settlements. I'm working under the Tamil Nadu Urban Sanitation Support Program, TNUSSP, launched in 2015 with the support from Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation, BMGF. TNUSSP assists the government of Tamil Nadu, GOTN, in achieving comprehensive urban sanitation in the state. I am here to present our comparative study on fecal sludge treatment plants, FSTPs, that uses different treatment technologies. The co-authors of the study are Shamna M. Azin, Nishai S. and Senthil G. Tamil Nadu, a southern state in India, has a significant urban population of around 30 million people, governed by 649 urban local bodies or ULBs. Given the state's rapid urban expansion, households in the developing settlements heavily rely on on-site sanitation systems for their sanitation needs. As you see from the containment system distribution data from the 2011 Census of India, various systems are being used across urban areas in the state. However, many instances of improper design and construction of on-site sanitation systems that endanger public health have been observed by ULBs. To enhance fecal waste management, Government of Tamil Nadu has established fecal sludge treatment plants, FSTPs, in addition to sewage treatment plants, STPs. Currently, Tamil Nadu has around 100 treatment facilities, out of which 51 are FSTPs to maximize coverage. Adjoining ULBs are clustered together to enable access to treatment facilities present in the host ULB. Through this strategy, 105 ULBs have direct access to FSTPs. The successful functioning of these facilities is supported by capacity building, quality assurance, and technical and field support. The treatment technologies implemented in FSTPs of Tamil Nadu include gravity-based systems, planted drying beds, and mechanized systems. Our study evaluates the performance of the three technologies, focusing on their operation and maintenance, and compares them with thermal technology-based FSTP in Warangal, Telangana, to provide a comprehensive analysis of various fecal sludge treatment technologies in India. Let's start with mechanized system in Perinaikampalayam, Coimbatore. In this system, septage is first received and screened at the screen chamber, which is then stored in a sludge-holding tank. The sludge is then pumped to a dewatering unit, where a volute press separates liquid and sludge. The dewatered solids are then sent for co-composting, while the filtrate undergoes treatment in the moving bed biofilm reactor or MBBR. The water is further treated with sand and carbon filters and disinfected using UV treatment, ensuring its safety for reuse. Next, we have gravity-based system in Kangayam. The fecal sludge undergoes stabilization after screening. The stabilized sludge is sent to drying bed, where sludge is allowed to dry for a fixed number of days and co-composted. The filtrate goes to primary and secondary treatment consisting of integrated settler and anaerobic filter to reduce the BOD load. This unit also treats the supernatant from the stabilization reactor. The treated water then undergoes tertiary treatment through horizontal planted gravel filter and post-treatment disinfectant in polishing pond for reuse. In Kunnur, Tamil Nadu, we have a planted drying bed system. After initial screening, the sludge is stabilized in a planted drying bed, dewatered and dried. The percolate undergoes further treatment at the integrated settler and anaerobic filter. The water is regulated by a siphon tank from the horizontal to vertical planted gravel filter and further treated in a polishing pond for reuse. In the thermal system in Warangal, the sludge is dewatered in a mechanical unit after screening and storage. The dewatered filter is treated in MBBR and sand and carbon filters and disinfected using UV treatment. The dewatered solids undergo pyrolysis, in which solids are thermally decomposed in the absence of oxygen to produce biochar and ensures pathogen removal. Having elaborated the various fecal sludge treatment plant technologies, we will now move on to a comparison of different technologies based on their highlights. Among the technologies adopted in Tamil Nadu, mechanized system has the lowest capex at $13,360. Planted drying bed is more expensive as it is challenging to construct in hilly areas like Nilgiris, but facilitates solid waste reuse, thereby reducing OPEX in long run. Due to its smaller land requirement, mechanized system is suitable for ULBs with limited land availability. The OPEX is comparable for non-thermal technologies, but both mechanized and thermal technologies require highly skilled personnel for operation and maintenance. Despite higher initial cost, non-thermal treatment methods provide solid manure that can be reused. While assessing FSTPs in Tamil Nadu, we observed a few operation maintenance activities that required improvement to sustain their operational efficiency. Firstly, in sludge management, efforts were required to establish a sludge yard and further processing of solid waste. Under infrastructure, focus was needed on mechanical component maintenance and waste removal. Thirdly, proper training for operation and maintenance personnel and efficient operation maintenance contract management were noted. To summarize the presentation, many factors contribute to the selection of fecal sludge treatment technology. Importantly, land availability, capital investment, and skilled personnel. In any FSTP, carrying out proper operation maintenance activity is essential for its effective functioning, sustainable reuse of waste, and in safeguarding public health. The Government of Tamil Nadu has demonstrated the significance of this strategic focus by successful implementation of 37 operational and 14 under construction FSTPs. Therefore, in planning an FSTP, it is well advised to consider long-term sustainability, effective operation maintenance for efficient technology implementation. For further reading, I recommend following resources: Septage Management Regulations and Operative Guidelines 2023, Detailed Commissioning and Operation and Maintenance Manual for Fecal Sludge Treatment Plants in Tamil Nadu by TNUSSP, Fecal Sludge and Septage Management in Urban Areas, Services and Business Models by NFSSM Alliance and Niti Aayog 2021, Business Models for Fecal Sludge Treatment in India by WASH Institute, Fecal Sludge and Septage Treatment with Thermal Processes at Warangal by CSE. For more information, please visit our website at www.tnussp.co.in. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Sakti, for your presentation. That was very nice. Yes, we can see you again. Can you hear us okay, right?
Yeah, we can hear you.
Yes. Okay, Pranesh, do you want to see if there are any questions? I don't see any. Yeah, let me ask you one question while we are waiting for other questions from the floor. I wanted to ask you about the composting. you said that you're using fecal material for composting. Can you say a little bit about the use of that compost?
Yes.
And are you facing potential obstacles or resistance in using such a compost coming from fecal material?
See, currently we do have around 40 operational FSTPs. So the co-composting is being done at around 10 ULBs. So we just take the dried fecal sludge from our drying bed. We just mix with the vegetable waste that is being collected from market and households in the nearby areas. So we just shred the vegetable waste and mix the dried fecal sludge with vegetable waste at the ratio of 1:3. So one part of fecal sludge, whereas three part of vegetable waste, and we just co-compost. Whereas in terms of usage, so there is a good demand from the horticulture and other people who are doing other like so flowering and other people. So they are getting our compost. So currently we don't face such much challenges with composting.
Okay. So people are not resisting using that type of compost for growing food.
Yes. So at certain places they are hesitant to use. At certain places the demand is high. So it depends on place to place.
Okay. Good. Do we have any other questions from the floor?
Not really.
No. Do you have any questions from this?
Not really. I'm from the same city, so.
Sakti, in that case, just a quick question regarding the anaerobic treatment that you have. You said that you are using that to lower BOD of your effluents. So how successful is that?
Once again, your question, please.
What is the reduction in BOD following anaerobic treatment?
So we get the BOD less than 30. So BOD reduction from the inlet to outlet. So inlet is more than around 500. Sometimes it goes up to 1000 also. And outlet, we just get the BOD around less than or equal to 30.
I see. Okay, that sounds good. We have one question from Kaspar in the chat section. You can see it probably. Can we see the whole report somewhere online about the study?
So that is what in the final link. In the final part of my presentation, I have provided the link. So it's open online, so anyone can access it.
Okay, once when we finish this, can you please type into the chat section again, if you can post the link?
So anyone can visit our website at TNUSSP.
Okay, please type it in. Yes, okay, good. Good. Pranesh, we don't have any more questions, right?
Yeah, no. I think, yeah, then we can move to the next presentation and they can connect through the conference cafe if they have more. Oh, that is another one.
So in that case, thank you very much, Sakti, for your presentation and for the discussion. And we will then move on to the next presentation, which is James Harper, Microbial Hazards and Household Use of Alternating Dual Pit Latrines with Lime in Rural Cambodia.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you.
Hello, my name is James Harper. I'm the Research Manager at Realize Research. And today I'm going to be presenting about microbial hazards and household use of alternating dual pit latrines with lime in rural Cambodia. This study was a collaboration between IDE, Causal Design, and Realize Research, and was funded by Australian Aid, Water for Women, USAID, and the Stone Family Foundation. So first off, a little bit about the sanitation context in rural Cambodia. Sanitation in Cambodia has been rapidly improving to reach basic sanitation levels, primarily through poor flush single pit latrines. Starting in 2012, there was a coverage about 30% of households, and it reached 88% in 2022 in IDE's operational areas. However, there remains low coverage of safely managed sanitation. So typically this would be achieved through on-site or off-site treatment and disposal of fecal sludge in safe ways. However, there are very few pit emptying service providers, and unsafe disposal and a lack of enforcement are really quite prolific, and so there is not much safely managed sanitation in rural Cambodia currently. So as a result, rural households typically perform unsafe sanitation practices. That's emptying their own pits without proper training or equipment, And it's very common to dispose of untreated fecal sludge into floodwaters or onto cropland as fertilizer. Pierced pits, which are as actually shown in the picture here, it's basically an overflow hole or pipe in the top of a single pit latrine, allow untreated fecal sludge to spill out of pits, preventing filling while contaminating the environment. And we've also found that climate change really exacerbates sanitation system failures and these unsafe sanitation practices. So what's really needed is an on-site fecal sludge management solution. And what IDE has worked on is what's called the alternating dual pit latrine upgrade. It's taking advantage of all of those single pit latrines that are really prevalent throughout rural Cambodia and upgrading them to be a dual pit on-site treatment sanitation system. Included in this upgrade is what's called a pit gauge. It's basically a float level that lets a household know when their pit is almost full. And part of the training that goes into this ADP upgrade is including the recommended practices for operating the household's new ADP, the alternating dual pit latrine. And this is one of the images included in that training, how to use your ADP correctly in the future. And obviously it's been translated into the local language and households are trained in how to actually operate this device. More than 23,000 ADP upgrades have been in use since 2017. And in 2021, the treatment effectiveness of these systems after 2 years, as well as the behaviors of households surrounding this technology, could be measured at scale in the real world. And that's what this study was all about and what I'm presenting today. So the two primary research questions that we aim to address in this study focused one on biology and two on behavior. So biology, looking at can households safely empty pits that receive lime mixing and 2 years of storage treatment as recommended by WHO standards? And with regard to behavior, in various contexts of rural Cambodia, do households appropriately operate and maintain their ADPs as recommended by IDE? So in terms of data collection and analysis, looking first at the biology side of things, we really specified our protocols really strictly. So focusing on collector safety, pit eligibility, sample collection, and labeling to make sure that what we brought back from the field, we could really analyze and answer the questions that we needed. We did a lot of field measurements, observations, and asked households questions and recorded this information in MWater. And we ended up with 147 samples tested within 24 hours of sampling. And you can see some of the equipment that we used here. The vertical device there in the middle of the slide is what's called a sludge napper. It's basically a pole with a sample collection container on the end to sample from a pit. And then we used compact dry EC plates to measure E. coli and fecal coliform coliforming units in the lab. With regard to behavior, we focused primarily on eligibility criteria up front to make sure we were talking to the right people. And households really needed to have experience with pit emptying, pit piercing, or switching their latrine pit connection between their two pits in order to be eligible for this study. In terms of sampling frame, households needed to have installed and used their ADP for more than 2 years. And the sample size, walking through the calculations, ended up with 765 surveys yielding around a 6% error. And the types of data analysis we used for behavior looked at response frequencies, correlations, and regressions, mainly to answer what factors correlated with proper and improper ADP use. So first off, taking a look at biology, these plots show on the vertical axis the percentage of pits that contained both E. coli and fecal coliform on the right. And then on the horizontal axis, these are the log of the number of E. coli and fecal coliform coliforming units. The red lines indicate basically the threshold of safety. Pits below this line are considered safe, unlikely to cause disease in humans, and those above are likely to cause disease in humans. So after the WHO recommended 2 years of storage treatment with lime mixing, pathogen concentrations were reduced to safe levels in approximately 3 in 5 latrine pits in rural Cambodia. While this is a good result, that really does mean that 2 in 5 of pits did not degrade pathogens sufficiently, exposing households who are emptying their own pits to health hazards. On the behavior side of things, really interesting results overall. We found that no households followed all recommended ADP practices. No household waited the full 2 years before emptying their pits. Only 1 in 11 waited longer than a year and a half. And 8% of pits were treated with lime by a trained service provider after switching pits. So really a lack of adherence to the recommended practices according to IDE. We did find that households really valued the advantages of ADPs, and these included the reduced cost over time instead of installing lots of single pits over time or having to pay to have them emptied by a trained service provider. It's a nice advantage. And also the required land area compared to a single pit latrine, and ADP uses up less land area. We also found that households generally lacked knowledge about ADPs as evidenced in their practices. So for example, 1 in 7 understood that they had to treat each pit of fecal sludge with lime once it fills. Now we also looked at a composite indices that describe the household's adherence to the ADP recommended practices. So this table along the top shows various household characteristics. And on the left-hand column, we have different ADP indices. And so, for example, the emptying index is a composite score based on multiple questions asked of households to indicate how well they were adhering to the recommended practices. And so if we take a look at a specific column here, let's take a look at flood proneness. You can see a negative sign in the treatment and sanitation attitudes rows. And that means that if a household was prone to floods, they typically did not follow the recommended practices for ADPs as much as households that were not flood prone, and they tended to not find ADP treatment and the processes involved as important as households that were not flood prone. So some interesting results there that will help us target improving the adherence to recommended practices going forward. Now, in terms of recommendations, on-site FSM systems, that's fecal sludge management, like ADPs, can reduce pathogens in fecal sludge in the real world, but it's really dependent on households following these recommended practices. So ultimately, our recommendation is both technical, the treatment and disposal side of things, as well as behavioral. Household practices around these technologies and services really needs to be considered in sanitation system design. Additionally, professional on-demand, safely managed sanitation services, including pit emptying, are really needed in rural Cambodia to allow households to safely empty, switch their pits, and dispose of waste, even if there are pathogens present. And we really encourage developing and institutionally implementing more practical tools that easily, accurately, and affordably monitor progress towards access to safely managed sanitation. So an example of this might be including core questions around household practices and behaviors in routine surveys and inspections. Many people to acknowledge here, various people at Causal Design, Marlena, Hannah, the University of North Carolina, Drew and Joe, thank you all for your input to this study. You were all integral to making it happen and making it successful. If you have any comments, questions, or suggestions, we'll have a Q&A at the end of the session. Please feel free to email me, james@realize-research.com, and visit our publication and preprint in these links. Thanks very much for your time and attention.
Present in this call, even though he was here at the beginning of the session. So he said that he will not be able to take calls, take questions in Q&A, but he listed his email address, which I also am now showing on the screen for you to send your questions directly. So please use his email address, james@realizeresearch.com, to ask any questions. Yes, I'm just checking. He is not in the call. Yes. Okay. So that was the second presentation for this session and the last. Pranesh, do you want to give concluding remarks before we close the session?
Yeah, sure. So thank you so much for a wonderful presentation, both of you. And thank you for joining us for the 43rd WEDEC International Conference. And we hope we'll see you soon again in the next conference. Thank you.
Okay, thank you all.